been with Trump a lot. I mean, remember when he was on the plane going down for the Mar-a-Lago indictment appearances? I mean, he's of all these people still so in his inner circle.
Right, we're very much in his inner circle and very protective of the former president and protective to the point that Giuliani reached when, you know, he, you know, arguably sold his soul to protect the president and under circumstances that were improper.
That was former White House attorney Ty Cobb weighing in on new indictments that have been announced in Arizona having to do with the fake elector scheme that the Trump camp attempted to implement to overturn the 2020 election results. Now we're learning about fresh new indictments in this case. Yesterday we reported on the 11 fake electors themselves who were facing indictments. That list has now grown to include others, including Boris Epshteyn, who is a former White House aide and is an individual still very close to Donald Trump. He has not been charged before in connection to any of the efforts to reverse the 2020 presidential election. He is also so close to Trump that he was seen accompanying the former president to court proceedings on multiple occasions, and they allegedly talk multiple times a day. The other individual who has been indicted in the Arizona case is Trump's former chief of staff, Mark Meadows. Meadows, whose name is redacted in the indictment, but is listed as Trump's chief of staff in 2020, worked with members of the Trump campaign to coordinate and implement the false Republican electors' votes in Arizona and six other states, the indictment says, and was involved in the many efforts to keep Trump in power despite his defeat at the polls. Also facing an indictment in this case is Rudy Giuliani, Trump's former lawyer. The indictment in Arizona includes 9 counts from conspiracy to forgery to engaging in fraudulent schemes. Because the indictment remains partially redacted, it is unclear what charges Trump allies such as Meadows, Epshteyn, and Giuliani face. So we don't know exactly what their charges are, but we do know that they are in fact indicted in this case. The names of others who have been indicted remain redacted. Other individuals charged in the Arizona indictment, but whose names have been redacted, the source familiar with the investigation told CNN, include Trump allies Mike Roman, a 2020 campaign official, Trump campaign lawyer Jenna Ellis, who has in fact flipped on Trump in the Georgia election interference case, and conservative attorney John Eastman. Now the indictments have all been brought forward by the current attorney general of the state of Arizona. Her name is Chris Mays, and she was elected for her role in 2022, something that maybe Joe Scarborough should have looked into before he had a panic attack about how long it took to file these indictments. But Cenk, what are your thoughts?
Pausing here to deliver some honest truth as we do in our news coverage as well. TYT is facing challenges, guys, as the entire industry is. You know who could make the difference? You. If you hit the join button below, it's gonna make all the difference and keep us in business. We appreciate you, thank you.
Yeah, so I was gonna say the same thing because he's screaming about why did it take 4 years. This is the one case where it makes sense because she came in 2022 and had to prepare it. But Scarborough's actually really mad at Merrick Garland, but he can't say that because he's Biden's boy.
Totally.
So he has to do all of Biden's propaganda. So he has to take it out on this woman who didn't deserve it instead of Garland.
Yep.
And that's how this game is played. In terms of the case itself, very similar to Georgia. Very similar to the Jack Smith case. And yeah, fake electors, coup attempt, should be prosecuted, no ands, ifs, or buts. I don't know what their legal strategies are in regards to Trump since he's an unindicted co-conspirator. Maybe they're going to do the Jack Smith strategy of trying everyone else first. And then once you got those done, then you go after the big guy. So in Georgia, they're doing it the other way where they're trying everyone at once. So it's interesting to see the two different legal strategies. But overall, good case, important case, necessary case. Yes, we all wish it started way earlier, but it's not the prosecutor's fault in this case.
And just to give you a few excerpts from the indictment itself, let's go to graphic 5 here, where the indictment says, in Arizona and the United States, the people elected Joseph Biden as president on November 3rd, 2020. Unwilling to accept this fact, defendants and unindicted co-conspirators schemed to prevent the lawful transfer of the presidency to keep unindicted conspirator 1, that's how you know that they're referring to Trump, in office against the will of Arizona's voters. The scheme, according to the indictment, called for the fake electors to fraudulently vote for Trump, falsely claiming to be the duly elected and qualified electors for president and vice president of the United States from the state of Arizona. Defendants deceived the citizens of Arizona by falsely claiming that those votes were contingent only on a legal challenge that would change the outcome of the election. In reality, defendants intended that their false votes for Trump-Pence would encourage Pence to reject the Biden-Harris votes on January 6, 2021, regardless of the outcome of the legal challenge. And so I want to just make a quick note about that last excerpt that I read to you. You know, in one of these states that had implemented the fake electors, one of the fake electors was actually really smart, because she's like, wait a minute, you guys want me to sign this document indicating, you know, that I am, you know, the real elector here, and you're telling me that this would only apply should Donald Trump win in the courts and be able to overturn the election, right? She's like, I need that to be very clear that that is what the contingency is here. And so she's not going to face charges as a result of being smart enough to understand that being a fake elector is illegal and you're gonna possibly face criminal prosecution for doing it. The others didn't care, they signed the document and pretended to be the real electors when in reality they were not.
Yeah, so a lot of the fake electors were lied to, and that's real, and I'm curious how their trials are gonna go, right? So, and I like that they're here prosecuting the people, the architects of the scheme. And in some other states, they're prosecuting the fake electors themselves. There's logic in that. They signed false papers, that's definitely illegal, etc. But some of them do legitimately look like they had no idea that they weren't the real electors. They were lied to, right? And the number one lie that Giuliani and the others used was, oh, don't worry, this is just a contingency in case Trump prevails in the courts. But they have documents showing they didn't mean that at all. They were just trying to get other people to replace the actual electors, right? And some of the actual Trump, because remember, there's slates of electors on both sides ready to go depending on who wins. Some of the real Trump electors said no to this scheme. They're like, no, you can't do that. You can't say that he won when he didn't win, right? So now, last thing on this is, guys, number one, I think that the Democrats made a huge mistake in not calling this a coup. Because a coup is something that's very understandable. Like fake electors plus the insurrection on January 6th, and they never connected the two. And we've connected it before for you guys. You know, so you do the, you block the proceedings in Congress on that day so that if the plan had worked, and the reason it didn't is because of Mike Pence. Mike Pence says, oh, I can't certify the election, let's bring it back to the states. That's where they have the fake electors ready to go, and they send them in. That together is the coup attempt. And the guys who organized that aren't the schmucks on the ground that invaded the Capitol. They're Giuliani and Epstein, if they're correct in their charges, etc. Trump, most importantly, Eastman. And so if the Democrats had cohesively said this is a coup attempt, these are the two different branches of the coup attempt, it would have been an easier thing for most people to understand.
I agree, because look, this is how broadcast news works. Broadcast news doesn't actually care about, well, they do care about narratives, but they don't necessarily care about connecting the dots and helping audiences understand what's really going on. They're all about the spectacle, they're all about the video, right? And so they are hyper focused on January 6th because of the spectacle, because of the video, because of what they can help the audience see through those videos. And by hyper focusing on that, I think that they did a poor job in really diving into how that was connected to the fake elector scheme and how the fake elector scheme was supposed to be carried out.
Yeah, one last thing, every once in a while, Democrats online that don't actually watch the show will see me say something critical about Joe Biden, which is true. But they're like, no, you're supposed to lie on his behalf. Okay, now we're convinced you're definitely going to vote for Trump and you're definitely trying to help Trump. If you actually watch the show, I think Trump tried a coup against America. There is no circumstance under which I would vote for Donald J. Trump. None. I'm not going to say, oh, well, we only tried a coup once, right? So be careful what people are saying about us online as opposed to the reality. So you don't have to love Biden in order to know that this was a coup attempt. And so look at them and judge them one by one on the actual facts pertaining to them. And there is no, whether you think there's redeeming qualities of Trump, and I would debate that as well, this alone is reason to never vote for him. I'm not telling you who to vote for, I'm just telling you that I would never vote for Trump because he tried a coup against this country, and I love this country.
Thanks for watching the Young Turks, really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat, emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun. But you also get playback of our exclusive member only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.